before we actually discuss the geometric properties of the steepest descent method in detail, we'll introduce some additional concepts that will be helpful. And in fact, we'll discuss how the gradient direction looks like geometrically. All right, so for this, we'll need the definition of a concept of a level set. Okay, so what is a level set? It is dependent on the function f and a constant c. And then if I look at the function f and some constant c, then the set of points where f is equal to c is actually called the level set at the level c. And if I look at the set of points where f of x is less than or equal to c, this is the lower level set, and f of x greater than or equal to c is the upper level set. So let me look at another illustration here that explains this better probably. Okay, so let's look at this function of two variables. The plane x1, x2 represents the variables here, right? So, and then the y-axis shows the values of the function for the corresponding x1 and x2. What is the level set? I just select some level for the value of the function, let's say where f of x1, x2 is equal to c, and it's like I'm cutting the plot of this function at this level, and then at the cut, I will get this circle here, and I project it to the coordinate plane for x1 and x2, and this will be the level set corresponding to this level c. If I'm thinking about the lower level set, I'm looking at the set of points on this coordinate plane where f of x1, x2 is less than or equal to c. And we can see that the part of the function that is below this plane corresponding to y equal to c is given by the points inside this circle. So this will be the lower level set here, right? And everything outside will be where the function f is greater than or equal to c. So therefore, the rest of the plane will be what we call the upper level set for the function f at the level c. Let me go back to this definition here. So this illustrates the concepts of these level sets for the function x1 squared plus x2 squared. So if I look at f of x1, x2 equal to x1 squared plus x2 squared, so the level set for the level c equal to 1 will be just this circle, right? So the boundary of the circle. So this is the set of points for x1 and x2 where x1 squared plus x2 squared is equal to 1. If I'm thinking about the lower level set, this will be the points inside of this circle, right? Together with the boundary, so the lower level set is where x1 squared plus x2 squared is less than or equal to 1. And the upper level set will be the set of points outside of the circle, including the circle boundary. Next, let's look at how the gradient is related to the corresponding level sets, okay? So again, I'll use this illustration here. Here we have this level set given by this circle that looks like ellipsoid when we project, right? So, but assume that I'm considering the gradient of f at some point x0, which belongs to this level set. So essentially my c is given by f of x0, right? So because x0 belongs to the level set corresponding to the level c, it means that f of x0 is equal to c. Now, if I compute the gradient of f in x0, the geometric property of the gradient is that the gradient must be orthogonal to this level set, essentially. So what do I mean by orthogonal to the level set? If I look at any curve within the level set that passes through the point x0, right, so, and if I take the tangent line to that curve at the point x0, then this tangent line must be orthogonal to the gradient of f in x0. Okay, so, and in fact, how can we show this? So let's say, let me take an arbitrary curve. We'll denote the curve by x of t here. So what is a curve? So this is just some function x of t, where t belongs to some interval a, b. Think of variable t as timed, and as the time goes, you are moving within the level set for the level c, and your x of t are just the coordinates corresponding to your location at the time t. If you select such a curve that passes through the point x0, so it means that there is some t0 where x0 is equal to x of t0, so at time t0 you are passing through the point x0 as you are moving. So let's say you are moving like this, right? And as the time goes between a and b, so let's say this is the time a, your coordinates at time a, these are your coordinates at time b, and this is your coordinate at time t0. When I move along this curve in the level set, because I'm always staying within the level set, I can see that f of x of t will be equal to c, right? I'm always staying within this level set, right? So the value of f at any point of this curve within the level set will be equal to the constant, right? So, but this means that because it is a constant, if I take the derivative with respect to t, I'll get zero, right? So the derivative of a constant is zero. And now by the chain rule, the same derivative is given by the gradient of f. If I'm focusing on point t0, then the gradient of f in x0 transposed multiplied by x prime of t0, this must be equal to zero also, right? So x prime of t0 will be, in this case, a two-dimensional vector that corresponds to the derivative of the vector x of t with respect to t, right? What is x prime of t0 geometrically? X is just a function of one variable, so the function from r1 to r2, right? The derivative for x in t0 geometrically is just a tangent line to our curve here at the point t0, right? So therefore, that's why we have this fact here, that, you know, this product is zero, which means that the corresponding vectors are orthogonal. All right, so once again, geometrically, the gradient is orthogonal to the corresponding level set. It is orthogonal to the tangent line of any curve passing through this point in the level set. So which is the same as saying that the gradient is orthogonal to the corresponding level set. Let's illustrate this again for our function x1 squared plus x2 squared. So let's consider some point that belongs to the level set at the level 1, which means it must belong to this circle here somewhere. So say we selected x tilde, which is given by 1 over square root of 2, 1 over square root of 2, and then we compute the gradient of f in this point. It will be given by the square root of 2 square root of 2, and we see that if we draw the corresponding vector, so if I plot this vector square root of 2 square root of 2, and if I plot the origin of this vector at the point where I consider the gradient x tilde, right, so that will look like this. Okay, so you see that the gradient is orthogonal to our level set. So if I draw the tangent line to the level set at this point, we can clearly see that the gradient will be orthogonal. And now we can easily illustrate the steps of the steepest descent method geometrically. So let's say if I was applying the steepest descent method for this problem at the point x tilde, so for the problem of minimizing x1 squared plus x2 squared, this means that I would move in the negative of the gradient at this point, right? I would just move through the origin, obviously, right? So, and obviously, in this function, we see that our step size alpha k would be selected the way that we would end up at the point 0, 0, which is the global minimizer for our problem, and we would get the solution in a single step. In fact, this is a very nicely structured function, so you have the same coefficient of 1 for x1 squared and x2 squared, right? So this one is very easy to optimize, and no matter which point I select here to start with, we can see that the negative of the gradient will always point you towards the origin, and we will always get a solution of the problem with the steepest descent in just a single step, right? But in general, this may not be the case for even a quadratic function. So this example shows you some quadratic function and shows the steps of the steepest descent method applied to this quadratic function. So let's say if I look at x0 and look at the corresponding level set at this point x0, then the step that we take is orthogonal to the level set, and we are moving in the direction of the function decrease, right? So if I would take the direction of the gradient points in this direction, and it points in the direction of the function increase. Instead, the negative of the gradient points in the direction of the decrease, so, and we take this step, and this happens to be the best point along this direction with respect to our function that we are minimizing, and then we draw the corresponding level set at this point, right, and our gradient will be orthogonal to that level set, and it will be orthogonal also to the previous direction of the gradient, as you see. All right, so and then again we take the step. You see that we always move orthogonally to the previous step. We see that we have this zigzagging, and instead of going directly to the minimizer, which is given by the point x star in this illustration, we kind of deviate from the optimal direction, which should take us directly from x0 to x star. So this, in fact, shows a drawback of the steepest descent method. Like for quadratic problems, we behave like a blind man. In fact, in China, the steepest descent method is referred to as the blind man method. We don't really utilize the global structural properties of the function f. Instead, we are focusing on the local neighborhood, and we select the locally best direction, and we see that, you know, the best decrease is in this direction here, but it is obvious that the best direction to take would be going from x0 directly to x star. And in fact, if we use the second order derivative information, we can find this direction easily, and we can go directly from x0 to x star. But if we use only the gradient information, then in this case, we don't have much information about the structure of f. Just the gradient, which provides the local increase-decrease properties, and we can only select the best decrease direction, we end up zigzagging like this, all right? Here is another example of the steepest descent applied to a convex quadratic function. So this shows here actually the plot of the function and the corresponding level sets, and here we focus on the x1, x2 coordinate plane and see how the steepest descent method proceeds towards the global optimizer, which is located here or here when we are looking at the x1, x2 coordinate plane.
This is our driver. Please, do not be distressed. This is only driver seeing eye, bitch.
Wait, he's blind?
Only he thinks this.